हेलो
करने
मैम,
के लिए चांगले अच्छा टी भी कर
मैम
सकते
कुछ
हैं सर।
स्टूडेंट्स ज्वाइन होना चाहते हैं, उन्हें ज्वाइन कीजिए प्लीज।
Shall I continue, sir? Shall I continue, sir? A very good afternoon, one and all gathered here. At the outset, I pay my humble homage to great educationalist and founder president of Sri Shivaji Education Society, Dr. Bhausaheb Deshmukh. Myself, Dr. Vishali Kinnikar, I welcome you all on behalf of Science College, Congress Nagar, Nagpur, from Department of Chemistry. Any long journey begins with a single step, to preserve and protect our environment. Also, to have awareness, our Department of Chemistry organized a guest lecture on the occasion of International Ozone Day. For today's program, I would like to welcome our Honorable Principal, Dr. N.P. Dhore sir, Head of the Department, Dr. Arif Khote sir, Convener of today's program, Dr. Y.K. Mishra ma'am, all departmental colleagues and dear students. Because of the pandemic situation, we are unable to conduct this program by offline mode. All of us know 16 September is celebrated as an International Ozone Day since 1995. It was designated by the United Nations General Assembly as the International Ozone Day for the preservation of ozone layer. Our objectives of conducting today's program is to make students aware about ozone layer depletion and its causes. Allow the students to practice sustainable way of living. Let's we all work and contribute in preserving and protecting our environment. It's my pleasure to welcome our today's guest speaker, having a dynamic personality, Dr. Anupama Kumar, Associate Professor from Department of Chemistry from DNIT Nagpur. Let me introduce. She was former head of department from 2010 to 2013, having teaching experience of 21 years. She was Associate Dean from 2014 to 2016 at DNIT Nagpur. Before joining DNIT, she worked at the CSIR National Environmental Engineering Research Institute, NERI, Nagpur, which is one of the premier research organizations of CSIR India. Presently, she is also one of the board members of Society for Molecular Imprinting. Presently, three R&D projects of 62.5 lakhs are ongoing. She has filed three patents. I request our today's guest speaker, Dr. Anupama Ma'am, to enlighten our students on this special day. Please, ma'am.
Thank you, Kinikar Ma'am, for your kind words. At the outset, first of all, I would like to thank the chairman for this program, Professor M.P. Dhore, sir, for this opportunity. I also thank head of the Department of Chemistry of Shivaji Science College, Professor R.U. Khope, sir, convener Dr. Y.K. Mishra, madam, and co-convener Dr. Kinikar, ma'am. So, I'm very happy to address students. Students have always been very near to my heart. And I know Shivaji Science College has pretty bright students, and addressing bright students always will make a teacher very happy. So even I am feeling very happy today to address students. Today, basically, I will be speaking on sustainability through molecular imprinting. Idea, concept, and execution. Okay, so I'll be telling the students how the sustainability is important, not only for protecting our ozone layer, and how it can be achieved through molecular imprinting. So in layman's language, I would say that molecular imprinting means you have memory-based material, or materials which have got memory for a particular compound. Okay, it is in simple terms, I would like to say. So now the question arises is that how is this related to International Ozone Day celebration? Okay, so as madam has already, already highlighted, Kinikar madam has already highlighted that the first Ozone Day was celebrated on 16th September 1995. The reason, and this decision was taken by the United Nations General Assembly. So this was mainly due to the Montreal Protocol on substances that deplete the ozone layer, an international treaty protocol to Vienna Convention in 1985 for the protection of ozone layer, which was negotiated and signed by 24 countries and by European Economic Community in September 1987. Now this day is mainly intended to spread the awareness for the depletion of ozone layer and search for solution to preserve it. So today's solution, which I'm going to discuss, will be very unique, okay? Because the reason is that we all of us are aware that our country, India, is an one of the main occupations of Indians is agriculture. And the growing need and the growing population has also increased the agricultural activities manifold. But then the produce which is produced in the farm, okay, when it is transported and when it is utilized in the form of food processing and all, lot of waste is generated. So usually what is the criteria is people tend to throw away this waste, okay, in the on land. And once thrown, they are being of biodegradable nature, lot of methane is produced, okay. you know, which is one of the gases, main gases liberated during the biodegradation. And methane being is not only a greenhouse gas, and it is contributing to the climate change by increasing the temperature on the earth, but then it is also, it has destructive effect on ozone layer as well. So my efforts today would be to make aware students that in order to make a self-reliant India, which is our Prime Minister Honorable Narendra Modi's dream, to make a self-reliant India or Atmanirbhar Bharat, okay, in this I strongly feel that the young people, like the students, they will have to play a very, very important role. And in order to find solution for the daily problems or the day-to-day problems which are arising, it is very important that you have to identify the problem, or one has to do the problem identification, okay, and then you need to do a creative thinking behind that. And this creative thinking then can help you in getting a solution in order to execute it. So this I'll be telling you using some research work which has been conducted in my lab, and I'm very sure you'll find it very interesting. So with this, I hope I can share my screen. So I'll just share the screen and go ahead with that. So I hope my screen is visible. Kinikar ma'am, is my screen visible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Visible.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'll be speaking on sustainability through molecular imprinting. And as I told you, molecular imprinting means it is a technique which helps in making memory-based material, or materials which are having memory for a particular compound. Idea, concept, and execution. So having said this, let us proceed. Yeah. So now the question arises is, what is sustainability? So all of us know sustainability is about being socially responsible and protecting our environment, which in turn takes care not only of the human beings but also of the ecological health. Then we also know that sustainability mainly is made up of three main pillars, that is economy, society, and environment. Okay, now, all of you must have already learned that if I say what is sustainable development, it means not only that humankind should satisfy its current needs, but he has to do that without compromising the ability of future generation doing the same. Now, it's not only the sustainable development means one has to satisfy the current needs, and you know, then you have to make sure that you are doing that without compromising the ability of the future generation. That is one thing. But along with it, it also comes the idea of societal progress and an increase in the quality of life. So when I speak about increase in quality of life, one of the very important goals of sustainability is ensuring good health and well-being of all the human beings on this earth. Okay, so we'll be mainly focusing on ensuring good health and well-being of all. So now, in this regard, we'll be focusing, because you know, sustainability can be in many, many fields. So we are going to focus on the sustainable use of agro-industrial waste, as India is an agricultural country and lot of biomass is generated, during the processing, after use, during food processing and so on. So now let us see some facts. We all are aware that India is world's second largest producer of fruits and vegetables. Food processing sector is critical to India's development because it establishes a vital link between two pillars of the economy, that is industry and agriculture. Food processing industry accounts for 9% of total manufacturing sector in India. Then development of agro-industrial sector in India, it generates approximately 1.81 million tons of waste every year. Very huge, number. Especially from fruits and vegetable processing industry during its processing, packing, distribution and consumption. Okay, so the question arises, what happens to this agro-industrial waste? So the waste generated, which is mainly due to the fruits and vegetable peels and their seeds, Okay, what happens in some cases, the volume of waste obtained after food processing is much larger than the product itself. For example, if you are taking out juices and all from the fruits, if you take Mosambi, because this is a season of Mosambi, you can see that the waste produces much more than the juice which is obtained out of Mosambi. Okay, so then in most instances, what we do with the waste, it is discarded. It ends up filling up the land spaces and causes environmental issue due to foul smell and high biodegradable capacity. But then the fact is that the peels, the seeds and pomace, they contain high value compound, including antioxidants, dietary fibers and bioactive compounds, among others, and their recovery can be economically beneficial. So what are antioxidants basically? These are bioactive compounds. They are of high value, but they are obtained in low volumes from this waste, they are present in low volumes in the peels, and they are widely used for preservation technology and contemporary healthcare. Okay, so with this preamble, now the question arises is that, and agriculture and food processing residues, they are attractive sources of natural antioxidants. Okay, so with this perspective, what a student can do is, you can start identifying the problem. Okay, I'm just giving you an example, citing an example, taking the example of agro-industrial waste. So you can start identifying the problem. So problem finding or problem identification, students, it is often a matter of perspective. So what do you understand by this? For example, if you have a glass of water, okay, kept on this table, some of you can think that the glass is half full. Some of you can think the glass is half empty, or some of you may feel that the glass needs resizing. So it is a matter in which it is one's perspective in which he is trying to identify the problem. But for finding the solution to any problem, it is first very important that the problem identification needs to be done. So day to day, when you are going somewhere, or when you are in the class, or when you are being taught something, it is very important that your thinking should be in a direction which helps you in identifying the problems, problem statements, I should say. Okay, not creating problems, but identifying problem statements. Okay, so if we are today taking the example of agro-industrial waste. So what can the problem statement identified can be? There can be several statements. Let us see that. Can I use this biodegradable waste which is obtained from the processing of food and vegetable, can I use it as fuel? Or can I use it as a fodder for animals? Or can it be used as a feed for biorefinery? Or can I selectively separate antioxidants from this agro-industrial waste? Okay, so these are some of the problem statements which a student can identify from the preamble which we have just seen in the few slides earlier. Okay, so today for the discussion, we are going to focus on the selective separation of antioxidants, which are bioactive compounds, from the agro-industrial waste. So now the question arises is that, why should I selectively separate antioxidants? What is the need? So first, students, let us look into the fact, what are antioxidants? So when, all of us, it's very important to fuel ourselves in the form of food, because then only we'll have the energy to work. But then when the metabolic activities are going on inside the body, a lot of free radicals are generated, and these free radicals, they lead to oxidative stress, which is responsible for lot many diseases, which you can see in this box. Okay, so here antioxidants, they play a very important role, because they are bioactive compounds and they are helpful in deactivating the free radicals. Okay, and it is important to deactivate the free radicals in order to maintain good health and for the well-being. So these antioxidants, they can act in two ways. That is, they are basically free radical scavengers. So they can act by two mechanisms. That is the primary defense mechanism, wherein they neutralize the free radical by donation of electrons, or using the secondary defense mechanism, wherein they do the repairing of cells which have already been damaged. Okay, so today, the antioxidant which we are going to discuss today, there are many bioactive compounds which act as antioxidants. We are going to look into the gallic acid, which is very important antioxidant. And being from chemistry department, let me tell you the, you know, chemical name of gallic acid. It is 3,4,5-trihydroxybenzoic acid, which is amply present in natural matrices of fruits and herbs. And it has got many properties. It is antibacterial, antifungal, anti-inflammatory. It can prevent cancer because of anti-cancer activities. Okay, it helps the body from prevention from oxidative damage by scavenging the free radicals. Okay, and then, you know, it has very strong in vitro and in vivo anti-cancer efficacy, especially for some of the cancers like prostate, breast, and lung cancer. Okay, so the U and also gallic acid, it's not only for the body, but gallic acid has also very important role to play in the chemical research, in pharmaceuticals and industries. As you can see here, it is one of the very important precursors for making an antibiotic, that is trimethoxybenzaldehyde, which is the precursor for antibiotic trimethoprim. Okay, then it is also used in the production of pyrogalol. It is used in inks and dyes, and also as a photographic material. And it is one of the very important component to form the polyphenolic contents in the and the extracts from the various natural plants using FC method. Okay, so these properties actually make gallic acid industrially as well as very important for the consumption for human health also. And the global annual demand of gallic acid is 8,000 tons. So now, if there are conventional methods to produce gallic acid, which is acid hydrolysis of tannic acid. So moment acid hydrolysis means lot of waste. So it is not, lot of environmental hazard. Then you can do it by microbial hydrolysis. But then, you know, microbial processes, they are often very slow and the yield is also very low. Then you have various analytical techniques which can be used for identification of gallic acid. But then it requires several purification steps and the reproducibility of the results may be affected, because gallic acid, if you are extracting it from natural matrices, it is present in very low concentration, and moreover, it is present in a complex matrix. So when I say complex matrix, students, you need to understand that whenever you are extracting some extract from natural, natural plants or say fruits, it has lot many bioactive compounds present in it along with the compound which you are targeting. For example, for this today we are targeting gallic acid. Okay, so all this compound together will make the matrix of the extract. So very important is that we have to find a solution by developing a new method for large scale separation and purification of gallic acid for its potential application. So in this regard, very important is, so after this, suppose if I want to find a new method for large scale separation and purification of gallic acid, then naturally I have to think of idea and concept. Okay, and this is achieved through creative thinking. So what is basically, before seeing what is creative thinking, let us look into what is creativity. So what is creativity? It is bringing into existence an idea that is new to you. Okay. And then if you practically apply this creative idea, then it is called as innovation. And for making this innovation, one has to go for creative thinking. So students, never underestimate yourself. Remember, all of us are blessed with an innate talent that you are born with, because creative thinking is an innate talent or inherent talent with which each and every student has taken birth on this earth. Okay, and only thing what you need to do is you need to focus your mind in thinking in that way, and then accordingly you should develop, you should enhance your skill. Okay, this can be done by learning and by practicing, and then it can very easily be utilized in solving the daily problems. So once you start doing the creative thinking, the ideas will keep on loading, and this will definitely help you in bringing out new innovations for problem solution or solutions to the problem identification, which in turn will help the society and in turn will help our country India or Bharat by making it self-reliant or Atmanirbhar. Okay, so with this, let us see in what way the gallic acid extraction from the natural fruits and vegetables, okay, can be done by using this idea and concept, okay, by making this idea and concept through molecular imprinting. Okay, so as I told you, molecular imprinting, basically it works by by using molecularly imprinted polymers, which I'll be referring as MIPs. Okay, so molecular imprinting basically stands for the polymers which has got memory for a particular template. So what is its principle? Let us see that first. So first thing you need to find is the template. So what is template? Basically, it is the compound of interest. So this compound of interest will be made to react with suitable monomers, okay, so that this monomers and the template, they can interact with each other to form a lock and key arrangement, okay, which is called as template monomer complex. As you can see here, this is also called as pre-polymerization complex, or it is called as template monomer complex. So once this template monomer complex is formed, what we do is we carry out polymerization using a cross linker and an initiator. And so when we do this polymerization, this template monomer complex, it gets, you know, freezed into the matrix of the polymer, as you can see here. And then what I do is that I remove the template. So when I remove the template, a three-dimensional cavity develops inside the polymeric matrix. So it's not just one cavity. You can have n number of cavities present in this polymeric matrix. And these cavities, they have memory for the template which I had taken during the synthesis. Okay, so this is the principle on which MIPs work, or molecularly imprinted polymers work. So I repeat again, molecularly imprinted polymers, they are basically polymers with a memory for a particular compound. Okay, so basically what we are doing is that because we are using this template or compound of interest during the synthesis, this is the reason why the memory is created within the polymeric matrix. Okay, and this helps in very effective molecular recognition. So now with this, let us do that. Let us, go ahead. Now anything, although it sounds simpler, it may not be that simple. Yeah, it may not be that simple. The reason is that, when I'm making a polymer, as all of you are aware, you have n number of monomers available. So now if my template or the compound of interest today is gallic acid, so which monomer I should select? That is a big question. Which monomer out of so many monomers, which monomer I should select? So it was very important to select this appropriate monomer to avoid the hit and trial work. So what we did was, what you can do, so before I actually go to the computational modeling, we designed this polymer, a memory-based polymer, using molecular modeling, okay, or a computational modeling. So what I will do is, before we go for that, what I would do is, I would tell you the characteristic features of MIP. That is, they have very good physical and mechanical strength. They are very stable in the presence of acid and bases. Okay, they are highly resistant to temperature and elevated pressure, and they have very good storage life, and they can be recycled and reused, which is also one of the very important principles of sustainability. Okay, and this is the reason why, MIPs, they are used for various applications. As you can see here, they are used for drug delivery, in sensors, they are used as catalysts for enantiomeric separations and so on. Okay, so now what we did, So now in order to execute this, in order to execute the idea of using MIPs, that is molecularly imprinted polymer, for selective extraction of gallic acid, especially from the natural fruits and herbs, okay, naturally I had to execute the idea. So for execution of idea, I would like to read this quote given by Swami Vivekanand. He was a great man, he was a great spiritual leader. Okay, so what Swami Vivekanand says that, but as if you really want to do something, and you have to see that it by, I mean, it is positively done. So then take up one idea, make that one idea your life, think of it, dream of it, live in that, in on that idea. Let the brain, muscles, nerves, and every part of your body be full of that idea, and just leave every other idea alone. This is the way to success, and that is the way great spiritual giants are produced. Okay, so for execution of the idea, for today's problem statement, that is how to selectively separate gallic acid, which is an important antioxidant, from the fruits and vegetable matrix, which is very complex matrix, for which we are trying to use molecularly imprinted polymer. The first thing which we did was we went for the molecular modeling. Okay, so molecular modeling, what I did using molecular modeling was I selected the appropriate functional monomer or monomer which were appropriate to the gallic acid for making molecularly imprinted or memory based polymers. So what I did was I designed virtual library of several monomers, and then I designed template monomer, that is gallic acid monomer complex, were screened. Okay, and this was done using computational model, and the software which I used was Gaussian, Gaussian software. And then what I did was the theoretical results which were obtained that were validated using the experimental results. So this is what I am going to discuss today for the execution of the problem statement, which is the selective separation or separation of gallic acid from the complex matrices of fruits and vegetables, because gallic acid is an important antioxidant. So now what I did was for computational modeling, there are several steps which I'll tell you very briefly, that is geometry optimization, frequency calculation. So in geometry optimization, I see that the geometry of the molecule is optimized, and then I go for the frequency calculation to make sure that my molecule is in the lowest energy state. Then I calculate its single point energy, and after calculating its single point energy, I go for the calculation of change in Gibbs free energy. And you know, more negative the Gibbs free energy, more is the stability of the stability of the complex. So this was the formula which was used. Now, why it was important to carry out the computational modeling study of the template monomer complex? The reason was the quantity and the quality of the molecular imprinted polymer recognition site, or the memory cavities of the MIPs or the memory based material, their quantity and quality, it is the direct function of the extent of the template monomer interaction. That is, more stable this interaction, better will be the quality of the cavities in terms of memory, and more will be the quantity also within the polymeric matrix. Okay, so with this, what we did was we created the virtual library of 18 monomers. Somewhere neutral, somewhere acidic, and somewhere basic, somewhere amphoteric. And then what we did was this virtual library, each and every monomer in this virtual library, it was made to interact with gallic acid, which was my molecule of interest, or which was the antioxidant which I was targeting. Okay, then what I did was this you can see the template monomer complexes of gallic acid with various monomers under consideration. So I'll just explain one of them. You can see this is gallic acid acrylic acid complex. Okay, here gallic acid is my template and acrylic acid is the monomer. So you can see here, this is the gallic acid, optimized structure of gallic acid interacting with acrylic acid, which was also optimized. Okay, so you can see they are interacting using a six-membered, ring. And, if you have a six-membered ring being formed, naturally, this complex formation will be highly stable in nature, because it leads to the formation of chelates. And chelates, they are highly stable in nature. Okay, so this is how we went for this. And so you can see the, optimized structure, which was obtained through computational modeling using Gaussian software. Okay, so after this, what we did was, with we made a table of the change in Gibbs free energy for the template monomer complex, in which you can see the gallic acid interacted with various 18 monomers which we had considered. So the highest negative values for delta G was obtained for gallic acid acrylic acid complex. However, we also went for the study of gallic acid acrylamide, okay, and we also took one intermediate complex which was having intermediate performance. Hello, yes ma'am.
Madam, sorry to interrupt.
Yeah.
Is it possible to change the slide now?
It's not changing.
Only one slide is visible, madam.
Which slide?
First slide is there only.
Oh my God! You didn't tell me. Okay. Just a minute, ma'am. Why it is happening? Okay, I'll just stop sharing and I'll do it again. Just a minute. Just a minute.
Now it's okay.
Yeah, now is it visible now?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Yeah, okay. So can you tell me not even a single slide has changed? Hello, ma'am. Hello.
No, ma'am.
अच्छा आप शुरू से स्लाइड चेंज ही नहीं हुई क्या?
नहीं
मैडम, वो पहली स्लाइड स्टॉप थी, उसके बाद नेक्स्ट स्लाइड आई नहीं, अभी आई।
ओह माय गॉड, आपने बताया नहीं मुझे। ओके कोई बात
ठीक है, ठीक है
मैं यहाँ पे मैक्सिमाइज करती हूँ। ओके सो यस, सो अभी देखिए, अभी दिख रही है स्लाइड?
यस मैम।
ओके so you can see here what we did was we took into consideration this four template monomer complexes, that is gallic acid acrylic acid, gallic acid acrylamide, gallic acid 4-valent pyridine and gallic acid methyl metha acrylate. Okay, these four were taken into consideration. So what we did was, yeah, now ma'am, is it changing? Hello ma'am.
Hello.
अभी
मैडम स्लाइड शो कर दीजिए ना, तो शो पे क्लिक कीजिए।
ओके मैं वैसा करती हूँ। ठीक है एक मिनट,
इसे मैक्सिमाइज कीजिए मैडम।
हाँ, मैक्सिमाइज ही किया हुआ है मैम, मैक्सिमाइज किया हुआ है। मैंने स्लाइड शो पे ही किया है, लेकिन आई डोंट नो व्हाई इट इज नॉट चेंजिंग, बट इफ आई गो दिस वे आई कैन यू एबल टू सी नाउ?
यस।
Yeah, now is it changing?
Yes
madam, yes.
Okay, I'll go ahead with this. Yes. Are the contents visible?
Yes madam. Yes.
Yeah, okay. Thank you ma'am, thank you. So, what we did was, what I wanted to tell students is that computational modeling, you can also do computational modeling for the solvent, because you know, when you are synthesizing a polymer, you definitely require a solvent to do that. Okay, so solvents can also be used, and we did computational modeling for various solvents also, and we observed, we selected amongst this solvent, we selected acetonitrile. The reason was it has poor hydrogen bond donor hydrogen bond parameter. So when I say poor hydrogen bond parameter, what you understand is that that is its ability to form hydrogen bonding with my molecule of interest, that is gallic acid, and with my monomer which I have selected, whatever monomer I have selected, that is say for example acrylic acid, was bad. So that is very good, because then it is not interfering with the template monomer complex formation. So it is only, this solvent is only acting as a medium for the reaction for various components to take place in order to form the polymer. So we selected acetonitrile, and this was also done using computational modeling. So you can see here, this is the results for the various, the four template monomer complexes which we had selected: gallic acid acrylic acid, gallic acid acrylamide, gallic acid 4-valent pyridine and gallic acid methyl metha acrylate. Okay, so then what we did after this was, yeah, I hope now the slide has changed, madam. Hello.
Yes madam, it is visible.
Yeah. Okay. So now what we did was, now we went for now the important was how much monomer to be used. Should I use the template and monomer in 1:1 mole ratio, or I should take a higher proportion of monomer as compared to template? So whenever I am synthesizing a memory based material, the thumb rule is that the monomer should be in the proportion of the number of the functional groups which are present in the template molecule or the compound of interest. So you know, in gallic acid you have four functional groups, three OH groups and one COH group, that is the carboxylic acid group. And that is why what we did was that the monomer was taken, the template monomer was taken in the ratio of 1:4. So we went ahead with modeling the composition, and we saw that the binding energy increased up to 1:4 ratio, and then it started decreasing. So 1:4 ratio of the template monomer complex was taken to be the best one, and we proceeded with that. So you can see the structures over here. Now what we did was, we also went for the optimization of the template and the cross linker. It is very important that template should have poor interaction with the cross linker. So we saw that the cross linker, which was EGDMA, that is ethylene glycol dimethylacrylate, this had poor interaction ability with gallic acid. So that was advantageous for us. Okay, so with this, what we did was, we went ahead, okay, and after selecting all the, all the ingredients for making the polymer, we went ahead synthesizing this memory-based material using different methods. So we went with bulk polymerization. So I'll not go in details of the procedure. What I'll do is I'll tell you the pros and cons of bulk polymerization. Although it is very simple and versatile, and you can easily do it in your labs as a project work also, but it is time consuming and laborious, and it has irregular particle sizes. Okay, so this is one of the disadvantages. So we tried other methods also. What we did was, we went with precipitation polymerization. So precipitation polymerization, it is very simple and convenient. It has good control of particle size. You do not have to go for grinding and sieving as you have to do for bulk polymerization. But the disadvantages are that it requires very large amount of solvent or porogen. Okay, and it is for carrying out precipitation polymerization, you have to use selected porogen and cross linker. So these are some of the disadvantages. So what we did was, we also went for the third method, and the third method which we used was reverse microemulsion polymerization. So here it's its advantages were that it is, you get spherical morphology of the memory based polymer particles. Okay, you are using large amount of water, and which is very green solvent. Okay, and it is expected to perform well in the aqueous environment. Moreover, grinding, sieving not required after the synthesis of polymer, but then you require emulsifiers and stabilizers in order to carry out this reverse microemulsion polymerization. Okay, so after doing these three, what we did was, we took pictures of these polymers. Okay, so you can see here, this is the polymer which was synthesized using the bulk polymerization. So you can see, okay, it is very rough due to the grinding of the bulk polymer. But then the polymers which were synthesized using the precipitation polymerization and reverse microemulsion, they were in the form of beads. You can see here. Okay, so this you can do using SEM. That is, there is an instrument, SEM micrograph. Okay, you can take scanning electron microscopy. You can use that, and you can take this wonderful images. Okay, so after this, what we did was. And remember, students, whenever you're synthesizing a material, it is very important to characterize it. Okay, so what we did was, so we went for its surface area characterization. So you can see here, okay, the one we obtained using bulk polymerization had very large surface area as compared to other two. Okay, but then the average pore diameter of the polymer which was synthesized using reverse microemulsion polymerization was much more, as you can see here, as compared to other two. So we went for this. This was advantageous because this will help in the easy permeation of the template during adsorption and easy removal of the template during its regeneration. Okay, so we did the surface area analysis. And then what we did was, we went for its experimental study in which we did the rebinding performance. So rebinding performance means adsorption basically. So if you remember a few slides before, okay, I'll just show you that because you have not seen. I'll just go to that quickly. Okay, you can see here. Okay, so here template monomer complex was formed. The polymerization was done, and then what we did was we removed the what we did was we we removed the template. Okay, so template was removed. So this I cannot show you because if I, just a minute, I'll do this. Yeah, so you can see here the template was removed. So this gives the cavities being formed. Okay, this where the cavity is being formed. So what I was trying to tell you was is that, yeah, just a minute, let us go to the slide. Yes, so rebinding, that is once the cavities are regenerated after removal of the template, what we do is that we took the gallic acid and we did the adsorption studies. So you can see here, okay, the adsorption capacity of the polymer which was synthesized using reverse microemulsion polymerization was much higher as compared to the one which was done using precipitation polymerization followed by the bulk polymerization. Okay, and then what we did was we took Embelica officinalis, okay, very difficult name, amla. We took amla, okay, we grinded it, we took out its juice, and you know, juice, amla is very rich in gallic acid. Okay, what we did was we added our material, memory based material, which was synthesized using all these three methods in this juice, and we did the adsorption studies under the optimized condition. So you can see here, this is the chromatogram. We went for the HPLC, that is high performance liquid chromatography studies. So you can see here, this is the, you know, amla juice. Okay, this is the chromatogram of amla juice. And then, so you can see this is the gallic acid. This is the peak for gallic acid, retention time for gallic acid. Then what we did was we added, we took the juice in three different beakers. We added this material, which was synthesized by different methods. Okay, we shaked it for some time to carry out adsorption, and then we filtered it. And after filtering, what we did was the filtrate which was obtained, that was analyzed. Okay, so you can see here is that this is the chromatogram for the filtrate which was obtained, in which we added the memory based material synthesized using bulk polymerization. So it gave, so the gallic acid which was adsorbed or which was recovered was only 31%. However, the gallic acid which was recovered when we added the memory based material synthesized using precipitation polymerization, it was 67%. And the one, the memory based material which we obtained, which we synthesized using reverse microemulsion polymerization, it was, you know, the percent recovery was 86%. Okay, or 86% gallic acid could be selectively extracted from the juice of amla. Okay, this is what I wanted to tell. So after this, yeah, so after, yeah, this, madam, can I ask you how much time I'm left with? Hello, ma'am. Hello. Hello. Okay, so I have just two or three. Yes, ma'am. Can I take, can I take five, seven minutes more? Is that okay?
Sure, ma'am.
Yeah, yeah, okay. So, yeah, so just I would like to tell you is that there are more, more ways of working using this memory based material. One is dual imprinting. Dual imprinting means instead of targeting one analyte or one, instead of targeting just one compound of interest, you can target two compounds of interest. So, and, you can also use dummy template strategy. So what we did was we targeted two compounds, that was salicylic acid and another was cadmium. You know, all these are very harmful compounds which come out in water on the daily basis. Okay, so, and now to make our polymer more greener, what we did was we used chitosan. Now all of you, the students who are interested in eating fish, and if you are liking prawns, and the shells of the prawns, basically they are chitin. Okay, they are a polymer, chitin. And if you hydrolyze this chitin, what you get is chitosan. So chitosan is very important biodegradable polymer, which is just like cellulose. The only difference is that here, instead of instead of OH group, you have an amino group which is present in chitosan. Okay, so it has many wonderful properties which you can see here. It is hydrophilic, biodegradable, it is harmless to living beings and so on. And it has many functional group. It has acetoamido group, it has primary amine and hydroxyl group present on it. And it is very flexible in nature, it can be derivatized. So it is a wonderful material, and in my research lab, I have a lot of work which is going on using chitosan. Okay, so I would welcome students, if you have interest in learning, you can always come and you can ask me and you can do some internship work during your summer, vacations. So with this chitosan, you can see it's a eucalypt structure over here. Okay, it is a polymer. So what we did was, we did some modeling also using chitosan. You can see here for salicylic acid and for 4-hydroxybenzoic acid. But my template was salicylic acid. Okay, so what I did was, I prepared this imprinted memory-based material, and here the memory was for two templates or two compounds of interest, cadmium as well as salicylic acid. And then this is the method which we have used. Let us not go in details. We used suspension polymerization, and then what we did was, we characterized it. So you can see they have spherical morphology. Okay, and surface area of chitosan was only 14.2 meter square per gram. But as soon as we did the imprinting or we created memory, the surface area increased it from 14 to 23. Okay, and the percent swelling also decreased when we do imprinting. And why percent swelling is important? Because you have studied polymer and you know that if a polymer swells, then its ability to do its work may decrease, in simple words. So here also, if you have a memory-based polymer and if it is causing a lot of swelling, then what would happen is that its ability to function very selectively to take up a template can decrease. Okay, so you have to do the swelling studies as well. So you can see on doing the imprinting, the swelling decreased drastically as compared to chitosan, which is having very, very high percent swelling. Okay, and then what we did was, we applied it to, futala lake. We took futala lake water. Okay, lot of idle immersion, etc. takes place here. And, futala lake also receives lot of waste water, which is generated from in and around locality, which directly goes into the lake. So we did, study, and we compared it with chitosan, how much percent salicylic acid and cadmium could be taken from using this polymer, which we had synthesized. Okay, we compared it using granular activated carbon and chitosan. So you can see the polymer which we synthesized had very good ability for percent removal of cadmium, which was 79%, and for salicylic acid it was 55%. Okay, so with this, what I would do is that I would thank all the August gathering over here for their patient listening. Okay, and giving me an opportunity to present my work. Okay, so with this, I would like to end, I would like to stop doing the presentation. Okay, so if you have any questions to ask, I would be very happy to answer. Okay, so any questions? If you have any questions to ask, let me know, students. Or the faculties, any questions? Yeah, students, anybody would like to ask anything? Okay, so the nutshell I would like to tell is that how it is related to International Ozone Day, I would say it in this way, that if this biodegradable material, which is in the form of fruit and vegetable waste, if it is generated, instead of allowing it to biodegrade, if we are using it in concept, using the concept of biorefinery, what is biorefinery? It is like petroleum refinery. Here, our feedstock, instead of crude petroleum, is our biodegradable, biomass. So we can selectively extract this antioxidant, and then whatever is remaining, that is dietary fibers, you can use it for various application, and rest of the remaining part can be used for anaerobic digestion, for for creating manure and all. So in this way, the ozone, we can prevent the solid waste which is being generated from putting it into landfills, and in this way you can prevent the generation of methane gas and thereby prevent the ozone depletion. Thank you very much. Okay, so if you don't have any question, that's what I would say. I'm very sorry that the slides were not moving and I came to know it very late. But nevertheless, it doesn't matter. Online programs, these problems are always there. But I hope I could justify my presence as a guest lecturer, guest speaker today. So that's all. Thank you very much. Yeah, ma'am, your mic is off, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am, for your wonderful guidance to our students. Now, I request Head of Department, Dr. Anil Khope, sir, to highlight today's event.
Good afternoon, one and all. At the very outset, I pay my humble homage to Dr. Panjab Rao, alias Bausar Deshmukh, a great visionary, educationist, and founder president of our parent society. Today, 16 September, designated by United Nations General Assembly as an International Day, International Ozone Day. On behalf of Department of Chemistry, I express my sincere thanks to Dr. Kumar ma'am to share her thoughts regarding the sustainability through molecular imprinting idea, concept, and exhibition. Topic was solely related to the environment aspect. In her deliberation, she emphasized on biodegradation, antioxidant play very important role in deactivating free radicals. Then she suggested the way of purification using gallic acid, a new method, and also throw light over the technique used for the removal of simultaneous removal of salicylic acid and chromium. Again, she showed some slides based on spectrogram of amla juice by SPLC method, then a method to synthesize some green polymers. Thank you, madam, for giving your valuable time to interact with our students. Thank you very much. I also thankful to our respected principal sir, Dore sir, for giving consent to organize this program and making event a grand success. Here, it is a very serious issue because we know we are using freon gas, CS gas, halon. These gases are weightless, accumulated in the stratosphere, which is one of the segment of environment 50 kilometer away from Earth's surface. And there, bromine and chlorine combine with ozone, and therefore ozone molecule, the percentage of ozone molecule get decreases. It is observed that one chlorine atom destroy about 1 lakh of ozone molecule. Now, because of this, some holes are created in the ozone layer, which we call it as ozone layer depletion. So, because of this goal, UV rays directly enter on the surface of Earth, causing number of things which I would like to put here, that is global warming. It may increase the temperature of Earth, ocean level, then glaciers are melting day by day. So severe problems which we are facing day by day. Therefore, to make the people aware about this ozone depletion, 16 September celebrated all over the world as a International Ozone Day. Here, I would like to suggest some ways by which we can save our ozone layer. First thing, that is, we can avoid the use of spray made up of CFC. CFC means chlorofluorocarbon. We may avoid the use of fire extinguisher, which destroy the ozone layer. Better to buy a refrigerator or AC without CFC. We can follow 4 RS policy, that is, reduce, reuse, recycle, refuse, think at home. Think means those things which contain this CFC halons. We can reduce, reuse, recycle, refuse. Buy energy saving bulbs. So these are the some solutions by which we can save our ozone layer. Okay. Once again, I extremely thank to all who joined this online program directly, indirectly. So with this word, I conclude my lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for the valuable guidance. Now, I request Dr. Kritika Ma'am, convener of today's program, to give a word of thanks. Ma'am, please.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Rushali, ma'am. Good afternoon, one and all. Honorable Chairman, Professor M.P. Dhore, sir, today's eminent speaker, respected Dr. Anupama Kumar ma'am, Professor R.U. Khope, Head Department of Chemistry, all faculty members and dear students. At the outset, I pay my humble homage to Honorable President, Founder President Dr. Bhausaheb Deshmukh.
Ma'am,
good afternoon, one and all. Honorable Chairman, Professor M.P. Dhore, sir, today's eminent speaker, respected Dr. Anupama Kumar, ma'am, Professor R.U. Khope, Head of Department of Chemistry, all faculty members and dear students. At the outset, I pay my humble homage to Honorable President Dr. Bhausaheb Deshmukh, Sri Shivaji Education Society, Amravati. On behalf of Shivaji Science College, I, Mrs. Dr. Yogita Mishram, propose a vote of thanks. Today we are celebrating International Ozone Day. For this, it's my duty to propose a vote of thanks. First of all, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to the Chairman, Professor M.P. Dhore.
मैडम तुमचा आवाज येत नाही ना.
ओके सर. गुड आफ्टरनून वन एंड ऑल. मैं ऑडिबल नाउ?
हाँ यस यस मैडम.
ऑनरेबल चेयरमैन प्रोफेसर एम पी ढोरे सर, टुडेज एमिनेंट स्पीकर रिस्पेक्टेड डॉक्टर अनुपमा कुमार मैम, प्रोफेसर आर्य खोपे हेड डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ केमिस्ट्री, ऑल फैकल्टी मेंबर एंड डियर स्टूडेंट. एट द आउटसेट आई पे माई हम्बल होमेज टू फाउंडर प्रेसिडेंट डॉक्टर भाऊसाहेब देशमुख, श्री शिवाजी एजुकेशन सोसायटी अमरावती. On behalf of Shivaji Science College, I, Mrs. Dr. Yogita Mesham, propose a vote of thanks. First of all, I would like to express my sincere gratitude towards Honorable Chairman Professor M.P. Dhore sir for their valuable guidance and moral support. I extend my heartfelt thanks to eminent speaker Dr. Anupama Kumar ma'am for accepting the invitation and sparing valuable time with us. Kumar Madam highlighted the important information about the sustainability through molecular imprinting, ideas, concepts and education in a very simple way. Your lecture was very informative and knowledgeable, ma'am. Thank you very much. Thank you once again. She also focused on how to minimize the depletion of ozone layer by using biorefinery. Thank you, ma'am. Once again, thank you very much. Now, I am very thankful to respected Professor Aryu Khope sir for highlighting about the importance of ozone day. Thank you, sir. I express my special thanks to Dr. KK sir for organizing a guest lecture in an online mode. Thank you, sir. I would also like to thank all staff members for attending as well as encouraging the students to participation. Last but not the least, I express my big thanks to our dear students for their participation. Thank you. Thank you very much.
थैंक यू.